vaulting Jordan Love, who in his last mock draft was not even in the first round, all the way up to being the third quarterback off the board ahead of Justin Herbert and the number six pick overall. Now, we know that he and Mel have a bet as to which quarterback goes off the board first.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Went in on that bet. It's interesting. I think that there's the intrigue of Jordan Love, and I heard Daniel Jeremiah say this best about the quarterback position right now in the NFL. You're either a shooter or you're a scorer. And meaning, listen, if a coach dials up a play and he gets you the open look that you can shoot and knock that open jump shot down, but there's some scores that you can create your own stuff. Like, you can make your own buckets. And I think people are looking at Jordan Love, and Todd McShay is looking at Jordan Love going, this guy can score on his own. He's that talented, the wiry frame, the very natural throwing motion. I would ask this, and this is a conversation that we will have over the next 2 months. It's very interesting to me that at the sixth pick, we're going to take a guy that led America in interceptions. Like that, I don't know if that's ever happened, where a guy who led the country in turnovers or picks goes at number six. But the upside, the intrigue of his talent level is going to be so difficult for a team to pass up.
I just can't take a player that high with these many question marks. Inside of 10 yards, he only threw four touchdowns with eight interceptions. And we talk about some recent young quarterbacks. Jameis Winston, Sam Darnold, Josh Allen of Buffalo. They turn the ball over in college.
Be careful how you talk about Sam Darnold here, okay?
They still turn the ball over. So while you've talked about ways you could get better, get coached, I just struggle with this guy's inaccuracy. You already talked about leading the nation in interceptions. I just don't see how you can put this player ahead of Justin Herbert, considering all the success they had. We talked about yesterday, if Justin Herbert was with LSU, we may be talking about him as a national champion, maybe talking about him as the Heisman Trophy winner. He's answered every question.
Can I dispel some of the 17 interceptions, though? And I'm not being a quarterback apologist, but those 17 interceptions, two of them were tipped balls by defensive linemen that just go up. Not a poor decision, not a poor throw. Mm-hmm. Three of them are Hail Marys. Three of them go off receivers' chests into defensive backs' hands. And then two of them because guys ran the wrong route. So, yes, there's 17 interceptions, but you didn't see like this, oh my goodness, careless quarterback with the football throughout the part of the season.
We are in the political season, right? And so you will hear things like a bounce. Everything is attached to a bounce. He's getting the Mahomes bounce, right? People are comparing him to Mahomes, and that's the bounce that he's getting.
And look, he's not Patrick Mahomes. Now, could he be somewhere close at some point? Maybe. It's going to depend on, as it does with all of these quarterbacks, where they end up. But I do think that what you see from him that's similar to Mahomes and why people are making that comparison is he can make all the throws and he can throw from the different arm slots. And that's what's really fascinating for a lot of these potential teams. But the interesting thing, too, and you were there, Josina, you know, in Indy, he said, I will own up to any team about every single one of those mistakes I made, every single interception. He's willing to sit down and explain why he did it.
Well, what I like about the discussion around Love is the fact that they're even considering this based on the performance that Patrick Mahomes had. And I like that as a positive net effect of the success that Mahomes had, specifically, obviously, going all the way to the Super Bowl. What you heard at Indianapolis is people are talking about how the ball was coming off of his hand, how it just looked like it was just gliding.
Natural.
I think with Herbert, I felt like I was hearing, they felt like he was guiding a little bit too much. And the other questions that you were hearing around Herbert, too, is just whether he's a natural leader, whether he was comfortable in his skin, because we're not talking about leading a group of college, you know, people. We're talking about leading a group of men who have mortgages, families, babies, you know, and can you really lift and make everybody, you know, elevate around you? And those are some of the questions I think that.
And I'm putting them directly to you, Mike Tannenbaum, who was the president of Justin Herbert's fan club over there. Go ahead.
Those are
the questions that
still have.
What are the answers?
The answers are really simple. He's elevated that program. And if you look at this season, Auburn scored basically on the last play of the game. That was Oregon's defense that let him down. And they had 1 3-point loss to Arizona State. And if we're talking about competitiveness, you look at Utah, the Pac-12 championship, the Rose Bowl with Wisconsin. He goes to Mobile. He's the MVP down there. And then he goes to the combine. He struggled early. I got a little nervous. But then he really started to throw the ball well. So as a competitor and as a leader, he's answering the question every time. And I've been around a lot of players. I think leadership manifests itself a lot of different ways.
Can I ask you this question as an ex-general manager? Because Justin Herbert grew up outside of Autzen Stadium within, I think, 5 or 10 minutes, right? He went to school there, obviously. He's never lived outside of Autzen, Oregon. What, like, how do you hand, if you're going to take him in the first round and bring him potentially cross country, What do you do as a general manager in a franchise in place to make sure that that transition, because that's a difficult transition. I was a young quarterback with Joey Harrington who went through something incredibly similar. And to me, it was very obvious that Joey was not ready for that massive transition that happened when, okay, I grew up there, went to school there, and then all of a sudden that's totally removed from me.
Yeah, that's a great point. Be it your quarterback or any of your players, you want to put them in the best chance to be successful as an organization. So every player is going to be a little bit different. You have to be a great listener. You want to encourage people to come with him. It could be an uncle, a brother, depending on the situation. But you want your players to be, especially early in their career, have the support system to put them in the best chance to be successful.
We're so glad you're watching ESPN on YouTube.
For more sports highlights and analysis, be sure to download the ESPN app.
And for live streaming sports and premium content, subscribe to ESPN Plus. We'll see you there.